So, good morning, everybody. Thank you for joining our webinar. The webinar focuses on circular economy of the wastewater treatment sector. My name is George Alidis, and I will host this webinar with Gijsbert Korrevaar from TU Delft, Daniela Kutka, and Joshua from Revolve, and Case Roost from ISPT. The aim of the webinar is to promote capacity building, to promote the concept of industrial symbiosis and support by the online BRIAM platform. Therefore, we have classified the seminar today, the webinar, in three distinct sections. The first is about circular economy and industrial symbiosis, and is going to be presented by Gijsbert Korrevaar. The second is about Zero BRIAM project, and the third is about the online BRIAM platform, and it's going to be presented by me. Between the sections, we are going to have some breaks, and I have also prepared a few polls, which are going to last 1 or 2 minutes maximum, in order to guide the discussion and topics that you see more interesting. The replies of the polls are anonymous for your own privacy. In addition, the webinar will be recorded, and the purpose of the recording is only to prepare a report later based on what was presented today and what was discussed. Finally, a questionnaire will be presented and distributed in the end of the webinar. I hope to have an interesting and interactive webinar. This webinar is part of the Zero BRIAM project, and it's about, the title is Online Training for Industrial Cluster Authorities. And the focus is to reach circularity and industrial symbiosis in the wastewater sector, as I said. So this is the first session with me, Ilse Aude Nieuweneme, and Dr. Case Roost help with this presentation. And also Gijsbert, Dr. Gijsbert Korrevaar is the guest speaker, and he is an expert in industrial symbiosis. So the agenda for today is to welcome everybody and introduce the team. Start with the capacity building presented by Dr. Korrevaar. Then we're going to have a brief break. And later, I'm going to start describing Zero BRIAM project, what it is, what has achieved right now, and follow-up projects that are already funded. Later on, we're going to have a second break, and then we're going to watch a brief video, and I'm going to give you a small tutorial about the online BRIAM platform, what is its purpose, how it can be used, what is the added value. And then there is a small questionnaire, a few questions that about the use and the potential added value of the online BRIAM platform, abbreviated OBP, that's going to be presented. Finally, yes, there is a wrap up, and we're going to finish in approximately noon today. My name is George Alidis. I'm a mechanical engineer by background, and I studied industrial ecology. Later on, I did my PhD in process engineering, and also I included parts of environmental performance assessment. Later, I did a postdoc in TU Delft, which was on the Zero BRIAM project, and it was about the sustainability assessment of the Zero BRIAM pilots. And the sustainability assessment included all three sustainability aspects: the environmental aspect, which was assessed with the life cycle assessment tool; the social aspect, which was assessed with social LCA; and finally, the financial aspect, which was assessed with the life cycle costing tool. Nowadays, I work as a project officer in ISPT and also as a project manager in Silo Corporation. This is it from me from now, and now the floor is to Gijsbert Korrevaar, who is an expert in circular economy, industrial ecology, and industrial symbiosis. So the floor is yours, expert. Thank you.
Thank you very much, George. And welcome, everyone. Although we are doing this for about 8 months, it still feels a bit special to speak to your screen from your home instead of addressing any real audience. But anyway, I'm very happy that we finally can have these seminars and now turned into webinars. So very much welcome, everyone. Some of you might know my face or know my name also from the Zero Brine Project, because I'm quite active in the work packets 7 on sustainability analysis in that project. But actually today I will speak mostly about circular economy and industrial ecology. And the idea behind that choice, and I'm also honored that I'm invited to address you about it, but the idea behind that choice is that the Zero Brine platform really has components that link to industrial ecology or to circular economy. And so what I'm going to do as a typical academic, you could say, is to inform you about basically the background that is behind such a platform. And so why would you actually create such a platform, and why would it be essential for creating a circular economy and industrial ecology? Now, as you can see here on my front slide, there is quite a couple of terms on it. And I hope to also, show you today in this, 40 minutes of my presentation, about what it all means. Circular economy might be quite familiar to everyone. Industrial ecology might be less familiar. And there's even a subset of industrial ecology. We call it industrial symbiosis. So you see that I played a bit in my title and called it the symbiosis of circular economy and industrial ecology. And I hope that at the end of my presentation, it is clear to you what that all means. Now, let's see if I can control the slides, because it must be possible now to go to the next one. George, it seems that I cannot. Yeah, then I go back to the original one. There's always technical things in it. Eh? Okay. Okay, perhaps it takes me a bit more time to control the slides remotely, because they're actually on George's computer. Well, George started with telling about himself, and I'm doing the same, because I think it's relevant to understand the background and the position that I come from. So I studied chemical engineering. In my time, there was nothing like industrial symbiosis or industrial ecology or even circular economy. So I'm just a typical chemical engineer. But I must say that I still work with chemical engineering topics, also in the Zero Brine Project, for example. But I really liked to broaden my horizon at some moment. So I really went from process engineering and process design to network design and cluster design. And that idea of that, if you want to make an operation or a factory, if you want to make it more sustainable, that you actually have to make the entire infrastructure or the entire network sustainable. You could say that is really the foundation under industrial ecology. Yeah, so industrial ecology is the field that basically says, the industry has an assignment to become more sustainable, but the industry cannot do that on their own, or one company cannot do that on their own, so they have to work together. And by working together, they can together create an industrial ecology. And so really an ecosystem of industries that, reduce the carbon emissions or reduce the water footprint, but also share knowledge and share information. Now, that idea of industrial ecology and industrial symbiosis, which is actually the in some way a better defined term than just industrial ecosystems or industrial ecology. But anyway, that industrial symbiosis idea, I picked that up about 20 years ago. And then I moved from process engineering into this idea of industrial ecosystems. The last years, of course, circular economy also came by. And you see that I also tell here that I'm working on it. Practically, I'm teaching at the university about circular economy. I'm involved in a couple of projects, doing research on that topic. And now I, and also with the 20 years of career that I now have, I can combine the insights from the field of industrial quality and industrial symbiosis and chemical engineering also in circular economy. And I want to present that today as, yeah, hopefully also some food for thought for you. Well, feel free to ask questions in the chat. You also can ask them directly if you wish, but then you might have to raise your hand or at least announce that you're going to say something, because it's always a bit one direction in a webinar like this. But I'm happy to take questions. It was announced that I would talk about industrial symbiosis also in the Dutch cases. What I actually will do is I will, during my presentation, tell now and then about Dutch examples, but also European examples that I know. At the other hand, the online platform that we're going to discuss later this morning is, I think, also a very good example of what we can do on industrial symbiosis. So you also will see that my discussion leads to such a platform. Make sure that I can go to the next one. Okay, so if we talk about all of this, so if we talk about the symbiosis of industrial ecology and circular economy, that sounds like a mouthful of terms, but you could say what it all is about is sustainable growth across the value chain. We all know that, of course, production comes from raw materials and needs transportation and needs many intermediate steps before we finally go from a raw material from nature to the product on the shelf. There's a complete value chain in that. What we actually want to do in all these discussions about more collaboration in the industry, infrastructural design, and so on, the things that also will come back later this morning. If we take that all together, it's all about a sustainable growth in the value chain. And you see that I have addressed here four items in that. I actually borrowed that a bit from the climate kick program of the EU. So that's also in some way has been a stimulation for zero brain, but that's the idea of that we can basically tackle climate change with a knowledge program. And then what are the things that we actually have to do in terms of the material side of that climate change? Now, I name four things here. I think they might be quite obvious, but still might be good to say so. So if we want to achieve this sustainable growth, we have to look for future feedstocks, a very important one. So not only the coal and the oil and the gas anymore for fuel, but also not just the raw materials from mines, but can we actually have new types of feedstocks? So that also needs, you could say new chemistry and sometimes even biochemistry and or advanced nanochemistry. So there's a new quest for future feedstocks. And that future feedstocks, you could say that they're directly linked to what we call circular economy. Because if you are able to get the feedstock from the existing stock, then we might be able to reduce the amount that we have to take from nature. But also there's future feedstocks that might get our attention, but also future products and applications. And those two things, the future resources and the future products, that enables us to talk about new types of industry. So there's also a large potential for innovation if we are able to actually use those materials and produce other types of products. And in the Zero Brine project, that is a good example, that we take the minerals out of the brine, that we are able to actually reduce the water footprint of the industry, at the same time restore and recover the materials from the brine effluent, and in that sense also minimize the amount of minerals that we might have to import from somewhere else. And you could say one thing that also is important there is not only just the circular economy, it would state that, materials stay locally and that they are, in some way recycled, although it's more advanced than just recycling, but it is recycled in the local economy. But we also need cross-industry efficiency. So the industries together, not only in the industry, so in the factory, are efficient. I think we have done that quite well in the past 20, 30 years. So I do not know, for example, in the Dutch situation, but I think that's for most of the European countries. I don't know of companies that are really inefficient. They're very efficient, but they're perhaps not that efficient if it comes to collaboration with another industry. So about if the waste heat, for example, goes from one company to another company, or if the water flow goes from one company to another company, that, or the hydrogen or the steam, that those cross-industry efficiencies, I still think we can gain there. And you could say, why is not that good at the moment, that cross-industry efficiency? That has to do a lot, of course, with the fact that these are private companies. So they have their own strategy, they have their own operation. And I will show you also later in my presentation that this mix, you could say, of the technical side of it, we want to be more efficient, we want to create better or higher effectiveness, that technical side is closely linked to the operational side. And that there's sometimes simply silos of companies that never talk to each other, but they both might have an enormous potential for each other to collaborate. Now, a platform is very important there. And so you could say that the online platform is in the cross-industry efficiency. It can lead to circular economy, and it would be great if it also leads to, the use of future feedstocks and the use of, or the production of future products and applications. I thought about this presentation before, of course. I thought, I'm a guest speaker here, so I like to show you a couple of concepts that are important. So to also stimulate the thinking about this, it's a highly complex discussion. If we talk about changing the industry's strategy, actually, that's what we're talking about, and how to think about other types of production and collaboration. If I take this picture, perhaps some people have seen it before, this picture of system levels, I think, it came about already in the early 2000s or so. It is a picture that shows that sustainability comes with several levels. And I will illustrate that very simply by saying, what if you would have a single company that wants to make any sustainability changes? You could say, then I make the energy efficiency a bit higher. I make sure that I use different types of products. My emissions become somewhat lower. And you could say those are all level one process change environment improvements. And those are important. And you see a couple of abbreviations in this picture. So in the left side, you see CP, for example, that is for cleaner production. Now, cleaner production is a great idea of basically making a factory more clean. Now, that's an important step to take. But if all the companies would do that, and actually we could basically say we are in this at the moment, all companies have already done that, have made a lot of improvements to the processes, they have done cleaner production. If everyone is doing that on their own, then there's perhaps not a possibility to go to the next level. And what is the next level? Now, that is, you could say, that is that really the value chain is improved, so that we have an understanding of the factories play a role in the life cycle or in the value chain. And that means that, if one company in the Netherlands takes raw materials from outside the Netherlands in another country in Europe or outside Europe, then perhaps in that other place where actually the materials come from, there's not so much cleaner production at the moment. So that means that actually in the end, my entire value chain still has a high emission of carbon or a high emission of other pollutants. So how to make that value chain improvement? Now, you could say that's then the level two. And so we can go go one step further, because if you say, well, we have done the technical side of that, we have made the product changes and the value chain improvements, we also have to make organizational improvements. And you see a lot of abbreviations there. I'm not going to explain those abbreviations, but EMS, for example, stands for Environmental Management Systems, and the SBM stands for Sustainable Business Models. So you must think of those kind of things, as you need other types of strategy and you need other types of organization. And then you could say on top of that, so if everything is really becoming very sustainable, then there's even a level four that says, yeah, but there's still something else to do. And that is perhaps that not only the industry has to change, and this is perhaps something we even have had to take from the beginning, not only the industry has to change, but also the society around it, because the products that we produce as industry, they end up in society later on. But if the society makes a different demand, then actually we have to make other types of products. That's more like a system change. Now, this is a very, you could say, conceptual way of describing that sustainability and in that sense also circular economy comes with many different levels, and they're all embedded in each other and they all influence each other. And that also means that if you do research, or if you do basically develop a new technology or an innovation, it's always very good to debate where that innovation takes place, where in this entire, well, system change, this transition graph that I have mentioned here. Now, why do I start here right away? It's just early in the morning, and then I start about transitions and system changes and so on. I think it's important to keep that in mind. If we talk about the changes that we can make as also as stakeholders, for example, in ZeroBrain, as partners in a European project, it's always good to position ourselves in such a scheme. And if I would look at ZeroBrain, then I would say, well, level two and three, that's mostly what we do. And we might have the possibility to do something on level four. And that's also why I mention it today as the symbiosis of circular economy and industrial ecology. Yeah, that's already moving towards level four. But I think that mostly our European project, ZeroBrain, has elements of level two and three in it. Level one already passed. We assume that the industries that we work with already have high efficient processes and so on. But how is it with their exchange and their relations to each other? That's the basis of the online platform. Now I went too fast. To mention one other conceptual thing, and then it becomes hopefully more concrete, and that is that besides this system change thinking, so this transition thinking, there's also this notion of decoupling. And I think that most of you know that notion, but I just wanted to mention it. That is the idea of that economic growth along the value chain. I started there, sustainable growth along the value chain, but the economic growth of the value chain, that economic growth should not lead to higher environmental impact. So normally we have seen that in the past, and we are still seeing that more economic growth, so more affluence, leads to a higher environmental impact. So more people also lead to higher environmental impact, and that is a kind of a linear relation. So that's meaning more means also more environmental impact. In this case, if we talk about decoupling, it's the idea that actually that we should try to see if we can decouple that relation. So if we can make sure that there is still economic growth, and there's also another debate. In this case, it's also a position and debate of saying sustainability leads to economic growth as well. It's not something like economic growth is not possible in a sustainable world. I think we still need that as well, also to get things moving, you could say. But at the same time, if you could make sure that economic growth doesn't lead to more environmental impact, then we have a possibility to decouple that. Now, that is a conceptual note, but it's something to keep in mind if we talk about sustainability and environment. I already said that in our work, In industrial symbiosis and in circular economy, you could say there's a correlation between the technical side that we have and the more institutional side. And you see here a long title and then also a slide full of terms again, but I think it's good to keep that in mind. And also, if we talk about the role of authorities and the role of organizations in an endeavor like the online platform, then it, of course, it's good to keep in mind that if we talk about a comprehensive design, I'll explain what it is in a minute, then we have to take into account many different layers again. So we had the system levels, but we also have, you could say, a layered system if we talk about a technical design. And so you see here, it's called towards the comprehensive design of energy infrastructures, because I also took it from a paper that is called like that. It's written by a colleague of mine, Rolf Kunicke. So the references can follow later. But in that paper, that group in TU Delft said, well, if you want to design an energy infrastructure, and that could be, for example, a heat exchange network, then, of course, you have to talk about the pipelines and the pumps and the heating system, but you also have to talk about all the effects of that design on the other layers. And you see that here. So the market activities of layer 4, they influence, from the bottom to the top, all the other layers as well. So a firm makes a decision, and that leads to, certain organizational behavior that asks for a certain type of governance. The governance, of course, is embedded in certain type of formal institutions, democracy, and so on. And that is even, embedded in how our culture functions. But it also works the other way around, of course, that a certain type of society, our Western society, or any type of society in that case, but in our example of Europe or the Netherlands, it's our type of society that we have with all kinds of traditions that has led to a certain type of policy that we're used to, that leads to the certain type of legislation, that leads to a certain type of how we basically make contracts with each other. And that, of course, determines how companies operate in our system. And there's a strong correlation between those. So if you, for example, want to understand why the building of a heat exchange network is so difficult, and that heat transition has taken already quite some time and people are still debating that, then for me, this picture is a very good explanation why it's so difficult actually to build this heat exchange networks. We see that they are built, and so it's not impossible, but it takes quite some time. And this, you could say, explanation of how, for example, a heat exchange network would be built and how difficult it might be. And that's more for perhaps the Dutch audience, that people know that also from the political debates, that it is hard working to get a heat exchange done. But that explanation can also work quite well for industrial ecology or industrial symbiosis, because there it works the same. And an industry that is really moving forward and says, okay, I have a lot of waste available and I like to trade that to someone else. I participate in the online platform, so that is my firm decision. But then, what kind of contracts are behind that? Is it even possible to trade that waste? Perhaps I can even not transport it on the road. So I have to first talk with the authorities. Is it even possible to get my waste from my factory to my neighbor factory safely and secure? That means that the authorities in the port region would then say, that's a very good question. We have always said waste has to be treated, but now it suddenly is traded. So, then we might even think about another type of legislation there, or perhaps we have to open up the permits. But if we want to do that, we have to go all the way perhaps to even national law and talk about the policy behind that. And then perhaps in the end, still stakeholders around it say, we simply don't want that. We don't want people moving waste on the road. And so that's really against what we see as good societal behavior or so. And so you can see that all those things link to all the layers. That makes it enormously complex. I have to admit that. You also cannot immediately solve that. But it's very good that we understand that kind of what we call system behavior or institutional behavior. Now, what is helpful here is that, and my slides also can function in that sense, of course, as background material later, but it might be good to keep in mind that if we talk about industries and industrial networks and infrastructures, that there's all kinds of different types of them. Yeah? So there's pure agglomeration. So companies are simply in the same street because they got an address. There's not directly a fundamental reason why they are together. They're simply together because it's an urban district and an industrial district next to each other, for example. There are industrial complexes. And I think that a lot of the zero brain work takes place in industrial complexes. So those are mostly designed to be an interconnected industrial network. But you see that mostly that is for chemical industry. So a lot of chemical industry takes place in an industrial complex. So you could say it is already designed to be a kind of super factory, although they still have a lot of private owners that all work together. And there's also the possibility to say, well, it is a network of industries. They actually do not exchange so much information with each other, but they exchange, for example, information. Or they even exchange employees. So you see that in what we then call social networks. And we always give the example of that Silicon Valley is the best example of that as a pure social network. You see many smaller companies, and then sometimes become very big, those small companies. But anyway, you see many smaller companies in Silicon Valley that exchange information with each other. They compete with each other. There's high competition, but there's even a lot of movement. So people work in this factory A, and then they work in the other factory B next year. And so they take with them all the expertise and knowledge. So there's a lot of social movement, but that is not so much of what we then call industrial exchange. That's not so that all the companies in Silicon Valley produce for each other the electronic equipment. Actually, all the electronics come from somewhere else, but the Silicon Valley itself is all based on knowledge transfer and that kind of collaboration. Now, those are roughly three cluster types. There's all kinds of nuances possible, of course. But it means that if we talk about our online platform, I think we mostly focused on this industrial complex. Although we could say we can turn, of course, pure agglomerations, so business parks that are simply there because they had a place and they needed a place, but that we can turn pure agglomeration into industrial networks and industrial clusters. And you see that movement going on. If we talk about, for example, the circular economy of business parks, that's an interesting debate that is currently developing in the Netherlands. So how do we turn the business parks into circular business parks? Then we're actually moving from the first column to the second column. So what we then say is, well, because of circular economy, we like to turn this business park of companies that are actually quite loosely and not connected at the same place, but we want to connect them so that they are becoming part of one circular economy, one value chain, and so on. I already sketched that there's a lot of complexity in all the things that I mentioned. So how to deal with that? So there's all those layers and system levels and many things. So what is very interesting is that a lot of designers, and so this comes from product design colleagues at TU Delft, but we also work with the same scheme, is that a lot of designers have already thought about it. Okay, if we have to design products and processes with all those ideas in mind, that there's different levels, how do we do that? Now, there's even what we call then a transition design theory that says if you consider in this case four system levels, from the societal system to the product system, how can you link that and how can you conceptualize that in your design work? Now, you see here a big arrow going from left corner to, so from up here and all the way down and then up again. And that shows that there's a possibility to think of a design framework in which we say, okay, you first have to discuss what is actually the societal system that you design it for, then the socio-technical system. And so you make it more and more precise towards the product that you really want to design. So P3 here, that's really the core. But then after you have then, well, thought about a great idea, you have actually designed it, it's a creative process, and then you have thought about that product, then you go up and you test yourself that in all the steps up, you make sure that you still meet the needs of all the system levels that you have passed through. Now, I know tell that very quickly, but the funny thing is, and that's the reason why I show you the scheme, is that there's an entire, you could say, manual framework behind that, and that asks a lot of questions to the designer. So in that way, you can train designers at the university. That's what we do in our Faculty of Industrial Design. But you also can do that, of course, with professionals. And so we also have professional courses. This is also one of the examples that we have all kinds of webinars to a broad public, in which we show that, well, you how you can actually improve your design expertise or professional work on that. And so that this is not only just one flat scheme, there's actually a lot of thinking behind it, all the questions, all the indicators, all the steps that you can take to basically take into account not only the design question of, okay, there's a product and I want to improve it, but that you really take into consideration all the system levels that are behind that. And to make that example a little bit more concrete, is that you see here an example of a Dutch cable manufacturer. So that's in Delft, even we in our city, we have a factory called the Dutch Cable Factory, but it's part of the bigger Prysmian group. So that's a pan-European multinational. And that cable factory that produces electricity cables. Now, that's an interesting one. So you produce an electricity cable. We all might have an idea about that. So the big cables for high voltage, for example, those are the cables that you produce. And they are there out there for 30 years, and then they come back. Now, they first had the idea of, okay, we want to move into circular economy. So now then we have to take our cables back. But they immediately had a problem, because if they take back the cables of 30 years ago, because that's actually happening right now, then they contained all kinds of metals that they didn't want to use at this moment. So they said, okay, we can take the cables back when they come available, but at the same time, of course, we have to make a transition that if we now produce new cables, that they are ready to become circular in 30 years. So you can already see that the circular economy in many cases is a very long time and long-term development. But at the same time, they said, but if we are now producing cables for the coming 30 years, then we have to make sure that in the coming 30 years, the energy system is still the same. So that means that we have to have a very good understanding how the energy transition will look like. Will we actually need high voltage cables? Or will we need more hydrogen or heat infrastructure? And then perhaps even have less electricity? Or do we need more low voltage electricity or more direct current instead of AC and so on? Now, and so you see that actually the simple question of what kind of cable do I have to produce today in order to become part of a circular economy in 30 years, that entire discussion again led to a discussion of energy transition and circular economy, all related to just the cable production. Now, that's an example of that, how you can decompose that problem to something that that can be done, but that it also needs a good understanding of that system. Now, this is another example of what we call industrial symbiosis. It's an example that comes from Switzerland. And what you see here is that, again, the same kind of thinking that I already explained. So I will also move a little faster here. because I have mentioned most of the things, but what you see here is you see economic activities. So that's important to keep that in mind. If we talk about industrial symbiosis or in circular economy, we're not talking about making one big factory or something. That we always keep separate economic activities. There's private owners, but they have to work together. So they have to do information exchange. They share an infrastructure. So they also might have an influence on that infrastructure. And of course, they have resources and locally available resources. And how can we move from having only the two types of resources also to have a part of recycling here? And what you see here is what you need is sharing of services and infrastructures. So the infrastructures are going, coming back. And that infrastructure is, that could be building a new type of transportation, a new pipeline, but also could be an online platform in which we exchange information. And you see here also the byproduct exchanges. So those are the things that are needed to actually make such a system symbiotic, to make sure that there's correlation. I've mentioned the word industrial symbiosis several times, but it is good to keep in mind that that's also quite a diverse field, because it's not only about exchange of waste, which is one part of it, but what you see in practice is that if people start working on that idea of industrial symbiosis, that they work on process intensification, but also new type of routes, smart infrastructures, all kinds of sustainability performance indicators. So industrial symbiosis is, again, because you are going to start a longer transition and a bigger transition than just going from one company to another, but even the network design and system design, you see there's many different topics in it. And so in a nutshell, you could say industrial symbiosis, that is resources, production, transport, waste treatment. That is, you could say, the industrial side. That is industrial side linked together with a mutual benefit. So that is the symbiotic side. So we call it symbiosis because symbiosis literally means living together in Greek. But in this case, we say, it's linked together with a mutual benefit. So that's also most of the cases, that is the opportunity and sometimes also the barrier, is there really a mutual benefit? If there's only one benefit from one side, then it might not lead to a very happy living together. Okay, and the circular economy, I think that's quite well known to everyone, is in a circular economy, we like to see more circularity. But what this picture also shows is that this is a very interesting one. It's a paper from 2015, in which you see that all the stocks and all the materials from the 27 European countries are taken together in one graph. So the numbers here are something like gigatons, if I'm correct. You see here, so the total production in the world is 62, and in Europe it's 12% of that is gigatons of produced. And what you see in a graph like this, and that's, I think, very interesting, is that a lot enters what we call stocks. That's a very important term in terms of, mass flow accounting, as we call that. So that if you want to account all the material flows, in an industrial symbiosis or in a circular economy, and of course it's undoubtedly true, it's very obvious, is that a lot of our things stay in stock for quite some time. A circular economy is not a fully dynamic system. And that's something interesting. We can have an exchange, but we also know that a lot of our materials end up in products, stay in the society for a couple of years, or sometimes even decades. I gave the example of cables. They're out there for 30, 50 years, and then they come back. So this is a very important, also slowing factor in circular economy, is that there is always a lot of materials stocked, and then at some moment they come free, and the question of course is, can we predict when they come free? Now if we talk about circular economy, and I just want to pause this one very quickly, because I also have only 1 or 2 minutes left, but I still like this picture, because if you now see it on your computer, you see basically only a lot of colors and circles. But that shows that circular economy still is in a very strong debate on what it actually means. If you are very much into circular economy, you immediately recognize this one. That's the butterfly diagram of the Ellen MacArthur Foundation. But you see there's actually many variations of that and all kinds of circles and arrows and so on. What is important here is that we realize that it even depends on the position that you take. So if you think from a government, or if you think from a company, or if you think from a university, you make different types of perspectives on the circular economy. Perhaps something we can debate later. This is my last slide that I wanted to present today. And that is, we wrote a paper about, you could say, basically the link between industrial ecology and circular economy. And what we did here is, because again, you see here many terms and many dimensions, but what we wanted to do here is to show that industrial ecology, and then also industrial symbiosis as a subset of it, that talks a lot about, now you see here, industrial dynamics and industrial symbiosis dynamics.
Yeah, so this is it. Eh? So what I wanted to show here is, in industrial ecology, we look a lot into the dynamics. In circular economy, you see there's a strong focus on business models and different types of strategies. And that's even an interesting difference, because it's not so much a difference of scale, but you see that also because of the people that write about it and that discuss about it, that circular economy has much more, well, flown into, yeah, basically the business side of it, also because of the word economy, I think, and that the industrial ecology has much more went into the organizational and dynamic side of it. But at the other hand, both can learn a lot from each other. So industrial symbiosis could learn a lot from the business models that are developed in circular economy. And circular economy could learn a lot from the enormous body of knowledge that industrial ecology has about material flows and emissions and so on. And that's where I wanted to end. So thank you very much for your attention. And if there are questions, please let me know. I will stay for the rest of the morning anyway, so I can also take questions later after the break.
Thank you very much, Gijsbert. It was very informative, very interesting. Also with the cable company. Are there any questions so far, Case?
Not yet. Not see a question in the chat. We're also a little bit behind schedule. So maybe after the break, people have questions. We still have some time for discussion later on in the meeting. But if there are any questions, let us know. Raise your voice or use the chat.
Okay, so before the break, I would also like to ask something. Gijsbert, based on your last slide, can we think of industrial symbiosis being a small part in a bigger circle called circular economy? Because can it be considered like circular economy, but only among corporations without taking into account the public? Taking into account, I mean, directly, because you already mentioned that the public make decisions.
Is Gijsbert still there?
Anyhow, let's have a 10 minutes break then. And yes, we'll be back in 10:05 to continue then with the next section, and also with questions if somebody has written something in the chat. So the next section will be regarding the Zero Prime project. So I will describe it in detail. And I think it's very well linked with what Gijsbert presented earlier about circular economy and industrial symbiosis. And yes, we'll be back in 10 minutes.
And again?
Yes. This time, when I checked earlier the chat, I didn't see any questions yet. Lorraine wrote something. And I had one question for Gijsbert before Gijsbert was kicked out from the software. There was a problem there. So I wanted to ask you, Gijsbert, based on the last slide, if I understand correctly, if industrial symbiosis is a smaller circle in a big circle called circular economy. So if I would consider it like a circular economy when only corporations are involved without directly involving public, the citizens, because you mentioned that the citizens are important and they can drive the transition or decisions, but yes, not directly in this case.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you for that question. And sorry about kicking out. In that sense, it's strange because I'm now running Zoom, of course, and I have discovered that before, that if you have Skype on your computer, that Skype completely disturbs Zoom. So that there's some, I think, software policy behind that. But anyway, so I'm sorry because my sound was gone and then I was even kicked out. But I'm back. I would answer that question in two ways. One is, I think certainly circular economy is bigger than industrial symbiosis because it's really about local, even national economies that want to change to a circular concept. And that means that it involves both industries and urban areas. And you could say in that sense, even the complete economy. Yeah, that's the, you could say that's the philosophy of circular economy. And then industrial symbiosis is a subset of that. At the other hand, if you look at what is happening right now, so in the type of work that people do, you could say that industrial symbiosis was already part of industrial ecology, and that idea also has been for long like the complete, what they called the metabolism of society. So that is all the flows that are in a society. So in that sense, industrial ecology has the same, more or less ambition as circular economy. And that means that the debate also has this edge that people that have worked for long in industrial symbiosis or industrial ecology, they always might say, yeah, but we already have tried so many different things. We know where we can gain and what is not possible. So we look at the circular economy and we see that people are trying things that we have discovered already that are not working. So there's a kind of a debate between two schools, you could say. I'm not that much a fan of that because I like to work in both fields, but I think it's good to keep in mind that I think circular economy practitioners sometimes even do not know that industrial ecology exists, but I think it's an interesting body of knowledge with textbooks and papers and works and projects that you can learn a lot from. And on the other hand, I think that the people in industrial ecology or in that field of environmental science, that they sometimes can be a bit more open to the fact that also circular economy, cradle to cradle, and those kind of very interesting new concepts also can stimulate, let's say, that they present their work more to the outside world. And so sometimes it's also a debate between academic and practical work, you could say.
Thank you.
Question in the chat now from Arjen. Arjen, would you like to unmute and ask it yourself and give also the interesting presentation he mentioned?
Yes, thank you, Case, for giving me the stage for my question. A very interesting presentation, anyway. Can you give us a practical example or location where industrial ecology or the symbiosis approach has been successfully implemented already as a first stepping stone towards a future circular economy?
Thank you for that. Well, at this moment, we are making an inventory of circular economy business parks in the Netherlands. And that's quite quite a long list, actually, of business parks that have this ambition of becoming circular economy. And some of them have worked with industrial symbiosis before. So, for example, the connection between Dow Terneuzen and the metal work around that. that's even interesting because it's a connection between Flanders and the Netherlands, so in that sense even international. But that connection has been industrial symbiosis for quite some time, and now really has the ambition to become circular economy. The same for the biopark, the Neuzen, that's also in the same region actually. That's also a good example from the Netherlands. And for example, in I must say it correctly, in the eastern part of Austria, in the Styria region, Steiermarken in Deutsch, but Styria in English. In that part of Austria, there's also a very interesting location in which people have worked with industrial symbiosis for quite some time and now have moved completely to circular economy. So they used to call it Eco Park Styria, and now they call it circular economy Styria, which you could say is only a change of words, but you can see that then also, yeah, the location really has moved into a stepping stone to circular economy. So I would say check that one out. Type Styria and circular economy or so, and you'll find an interesting case study.
You.
Thanks. No other questions in the chat?
Okay. Then I will continue with the Zero Prime project. So the Zero Prime project, like its title, it's about eliminating saline wastewater effluents from the industry. And as a result, it's very well aligned with the Sustainable Development Goal for clean water and sanitation, but it also is well aligned with other sustainable development goals regarding resilient infrastructure, about climate action, etc., because we are trying to not only eliminate the wastewater, saline wastewater effluents, but also sell or make reuse of the waste products, either internally from the corporation that produces the brine or from other businesses which are located close by. Therefore, I would like to start with a brief video about clean water and sanitation, about the Sustainable Development Goal. Let's see. And preferably from the beginning.
We cannot hear.
No, there's no sound.
You have to click the connect with the audio.
Sorry, audio is not. Okay, then very fast. I can
go to the website.
I can go to YouTube and then I can set it on YouTube. Give me 1 second. Set my screen. Thank you for that. Now you can all hear the audio?
No, still not.
Still not.
You share screen, you have the opportunity to click on sound on your left side of your screen. If you do that, it should be okay.
And otherwise you explain what you see.
Well, there is some text. Share computer sound. Yes. Thank you, Arjen.
Thank you.
So that was the video from the United Nations. Oops, name. Share screen. Let me share the presentation once more. And hopefully you can still hear me because I shared earlier the sound.
Yeah, yeah, we hear you. On the full screen.
So.
I think we see your presentation mode, not the full screen.
Not the full screen.
Yeah. It's your presentation. You share
Zoom is,
probably. We see Zoom, your own screen and not.
Zoom is always strange. But I wanted to say that, as you can see, the United Nations have given a lot of priority about water and sanitation because water in this part of the world can be, we have it in abundance almost everywhere in Europe, but there are some countries, especially third world countries or developing economies, where water is scarce. Not everybody has access to drinking water and drinking quality water. And also, water in the future is going to become more scarce. That is what expected, because even though there are the oceans, there are rivers, etc., where of course there is a lot of water, but at the same time, because of human activities, industrial activities, we pollute that water. And then drinking quality water will become a problem in the future for the entire planet. This is the reason why the United Nations have developed one sustainable development goal focusing only on water. And the Zero Brine, in Zero Brine, this is water is the focus, because brine is water with a very high salinity level. So at this point, I would like to ask you if you know what Zero Brine is about, what the project is about. So I'm going to launch the poll. You should be able to vote. And this is regarding, yes, if you have ever heard about Zero Brine before or not. The project started in 2017, so we are almost close to completion. There are still another 7 to 10 months. There was an extension due to coronavirus. I will explain later, or you will understand how the coronavirus affected the project, because there are big pilots where large scale experiments are taking place. And as you can imagine, it can become problematic. So let's wait a bit more.
Yeah, I think most people voted already.
Almost, I think everybody, yes. I will end the poll. Can you see the results?
Yes.
Okay, so 65% know the project, which is, or heard the project in the past, which is nice. 35% they have not. And I will thank you for that. I will stop sharing and close this. And then we'll go to the next slide. So let's start with brine. Brine in general is water with high or very high salinity level. And you can see that fresh water does not contain, or it has a minimally composition constituents of salt, especially or mainly sodium chloride. And then there is brackish, or let's say simply dirty water, which contains a little bit more salt. Then there is seawater, which has about 30 parts per trillion salt, and then there is briny water, brine, which it's saltier, it contains more salt even when compared to seawater. There are several salts that can be contained, can be part of brine water, but in most of the cases, this is sodium chloride, which is the salt that we typically use in our tables when we eat. Of course, that one, it needs to be pure. It needs to have certain qualitative characteristics. In the Netherlands, brine is disposed, and in total per year, it's almost 650 kilotons of chloride releases, and chloride is only a small part of the brine releases every year. And the peculiar case with the Netherlands is that brine can be disposed to the ocean. So there are industries which they are located, for example, in the port of Rotterdam. And there, because the salinity of the water is already high due to the open sea, then brine in certain cases can be disposed. However, it is not environmental friendly, and in many cases it is regulated, and therefore it is not allowed to dispose brine on surface water. The reason for that is that the toxicity of the location when brine disposal is going to increase, and the biodiversity, the organisms living at that point, are going to be affected. The project concerns a lot of companies. It concerns several universities all over Europe. Public authorities are part of the consortium. There are small enterprises, which can be technology suppliers. They can work for dissemination activities. There are consultancy companies in the Netherlands and abroad, in all over Europe, participating. And the project, in its focal core, in its core, it has four case studies. These four case studies consist of companies of process industries that are producing large quantities of brine. There is one process industry in Turkey, which is a textile plant, and there brine is produced. I will talk about the case studies in my next slide. So now I would like to focus that, I would like to mention that in the project, not only there are four case studies where pilots are going to, or were built, and the technologies were demonstrated next to the process industries with real brine, but there are also partners who are involved in the sustainability assessment of the pilots. This means that what are the environmental, social, and economic benefits if brine is going to be treated instead of continue treating the brine with the current technology, so we can call it business as usual, because this is the current way for companies now, for the case study companies. There are other partners who are focusing on the business modeling of the technologies developed in the project, and how these technologies can be replicated and applied in other companies that are producing a brine with similar composition, or brine in general. There are partners who are focusing on the communication of the project results and of the project in general. And also this webinar is part of that communication activities, for example. So the four case study companies, they all are, they belong to the process industry, but they are a really different one from each other. So, for example, in In Turkey, there is this large textile plant from Zorlu Textiles, and that sodium chloride is used in several processes, especially for textile dyeing. And as a result, there is wastewater, which has a high salinity level due to the salt used in that process. And currently, the company is already treating the wastewater with reverse osmosis and other technologies. There is a coal mine in Poland from PGG, and brine is produced because when coal is extracted underground, there is also water coming to the surface. And this water contains sodium chloride and other minerals. Right now, there is a wastewater treatment plant that is treating this brine and produces cleaner water, but also salt, and also some other byproducts like gypsum, which are reused by the coal mine. In addition, brine is not only generated from active coal mines, but also from abandoned coal mines. And this is very important because due to the energy transition, electricity generated from coal is going to be decreased. And if mines are going to be closed, brine generation needs to be managed. Then there is a silica plant in Spain. And in this case, the company is using a large extent, a large portion of the available water for everybody in the region. So for irrigation purposes or for people to drink it, and they consume around 10 to 15% of that water on a regional level. And as you can imagine, this is quite large. And finally, there is a ultra pure demineralized water plant in Rotterdam in the Netherlands. And in this case, the Evidence Industrial Water, the company, they are transporting high purity salt in order to regenerate equipment. And as a result, they are producing brine, which in this case, it is just disposed at the ocean because there is currently no problem, and therefore there is no regulation for that. So if I focus a little bit more on the Dutch case study, this information is already online. So it is public information regarding the processes that are part of that plant. Is that there is some, and you can interrupt me by the way, there is some lake water, so fresh water pumped, and there are some flotation methods that are removing some solids that exist in that water. Then there is ion exchange softening, and salt is used here when the equipment is maintained. And then the softened water is going to a reverse osmosis unit where brine is also produced because sodium chloride and other minerals are removed. And then there is a polisher. And then finally, ultra pure demineralized water is distributed to nearby companies in Rotterdam, where there are a lot of biorefineries and refineries, and also other chemical companies which need pure water for producing steam or for other purposes. As I explained, right now, the Evidence Industrial Water is transporting, is purchasing high purity salt from the northern part of the Netherlands, and they also dispose the brine to the ocean. So I would like to ask you what kind of benefits you expect, if you could think, in this case. So then... Due to the zero brine, of course, due to the zero brine technologies, etc. Okay, I see. almost everyone, the majority of people are expecting environmental benefits. And also people are expecting cost benefits. And thank you. So, sorry, the results. So almost 80%, 4 out of 5 responded environmental benefits. And in this case, and in both cases, stop sharing the results. Okay. And in this case, you're partially right, because if brine and salt is going to be recovered, then there is no need to transport the salt. And also there are cost benefits, because then the company does not need to buy huge quantities of salt due to the very high capacity. The capacity of that plant, I didn't mention, is 1,000 cubic meters per hour of demineralized water production. So, okay, I have to click. So the project, how it is decided and what kind of technologies are involved in order to treat water from two sites, from two processes. One is the ion exchange process, and the second is the reverse osmosis process. From the ion exchange softener, there is nanofiltration, membrane crystallization, and evaporation, which are involved. And in this case, clean water is produced. You can see on the right part of the slide, there is a regeneration, there is a solution which is rich in sodium chloride, and from the membrane crystallization processes, high purity magnesium and calcium can be recovered. From the second site, there is the NIEX technology, which is a technology regarding total organic carbon removal involved. There is again nanofiltration, there is reverse osmosis to further clean the water, and there is epithetic freeze crystallization and evaporation involved. Both sites, they have brines with different compositions. That's why the technologies, or the set of the technologies, is also different. And then from the second site, sulfate salts can be recovered, sodium bicarbonate, clean water, and the solution again rich in sodium chloride. The plan is for the company to reduce the amount of surface water they use as feedstock, and also reduce by 75% the amount of salt that is being transported from Groningen for regenerate the membranes in the ion exchange softener. The next site, the next case study is the Spanish case study. In this case, it is not allowed, it is not public information, what processes consist of the silica plant, but the aim here, the objective is to use spent membranes, so regenerate the membranes. And there's also another aspect of circular economy. So use something that was considered waste until that time in order to use ultrafiltration, and then with the spent membranes, use them in a reverse osmosis unit. And then finally, further further remove some materials with the EFC, again, technology with epithetic freeze crystallization. The objective here is to recover clean water, because as I said, the company is consuming almost 15% of the total surface water in the region, total drinking quality water in the region, and also recover sulfates, sodium sulfate. The expectance for this is to have almost 1,800,000 turnover per year due to the sodium sulfate, and also reduce the cost of that consumption of the drinking water, of the water, drinking quality water consumption. Then there is the brine from the coal mine. And in this case, as I said, the brine is already treated. in an effective way in terms of not polluting the environment with brine disposal and not polluting the rivers in Poland, because that mine is in the south west part of Poland. And the plan here is to use nanofiltration to recover some magnesium, to use reverse osmosis to recover fresh water and electrodialysis with crystallization to remove some salt. And so far, the project was efficient. It has achieved a 50% energy consumption and faster processing times. This means that environmental benefits can already be expected because less electricity and heat and other any kind of energy used, mainly electricity. It's almost time for the break. I need a few minutes. It's going to be expected. So there are environmental benefits due to that. Brine and magnesium hydroxide, concentrated brine and magnesium hydroxide are recovered. And lastly, from the Turkish case study, the water from the reverse osmosis plant is going to further be treated and with oxidation, nanofiltration, reverse osmosis, and ion exchange to recover clean water and concentrated brine solution, which is going to replace salt in that dyeing process. So far from the Dutch case study, we have seen the recovered materials. Environmental benefits exist due to avoided brine disposal at the Rotterdam port. Economic benefits exist when the materials which are recovered are going to be of high quality, high purity. And then there are also social benefits, because right now magnesium hydroxide imported from Russia is considered a high conflict mineral. And then European Union has target to reduce high conflict minerals consumption within Europe. In general, the project aims to produce circular water and circular minerals, to have less toxic ports and greater biodiversity benefits in the Netherlands with conflict-free minerals. In Spain, we expect to have financial benefits and also significant benefits in water use. In Poland, there are environmental benefits due to the improvement in energy efficiency and conflict-free minerals once more. And then in Turkey, there are potential environmental benefits due to the avoided products, due to not using salt, and especially avoiding using water. Furthermore, I would like to mention that brine excellence centers are developed within the project, and these centers exist in the Netherlands, but also in Poland, Spain, Greece, and Italy. And the purpose of these centers is to have bench scale and pilot scale equipment, but also analytical equipment for all the companies that are producing brine in Europe or in these countries. And then they would like to check, to investigate the composition of the brine and what materials can be recovered based on the zero brine project technologies. For the Dutch Brine Excellence Center, the bench scale and pilot scale equipment consists of ion exchange columns, reverse osmosis, eutectic freeze crystallization units, and nanofiltration. And finally, a few things about follow-up projects. Currently, there are three. There is one more that I don't mention here. There is the Life Brine Mining Project, which focuses on treating brine from coal mines in Poland, which is from the Life funding source and also from the Environmental Fund source, with a budget, total budget of 6.3 million euros. There is the Water Mining Project and the C4Value Project. Both projects are from Horizon 2020. All three of these projects, they started recently, the last year, 2020, this year, 2020, and they are going to base their development and their the further development of what is already achieved with the Zero Brain project. And for the Horizon 2020 projects, the budget is 19 million and 6.9 million for the water mining and C4 value, respectively. That's it for now. I don't know if there are any questions so far in the chat.
No, not yet. I think it was clear. Yeah. Also, a remark about Kalund's work in about industrial symbiosis, but more about that's more about a remark of the earlier discussion with Gijsbert.
There is another question for Gijsbert, or I didn't.
That was already in the chat handled.
Okay. And so the project, one of the deliverables of the project was the online brain platform, OBP in abbreviation. And in the next section, I'm going to present OBP. There is a very short video from Revolve and National University of Athens regarding the registration process and what kind of data is needed for registration purposes. And after that, I'm going to show you with my account in the online brain platform how to use it based on the different roles that exist. And yeah, that's it. It is, I think, a very helpful platform for achieving industrial symbiosis and circular economy among corporations, and especially when those corporations, where the, those businesses exist in the same region, then we can see many benefits. So we can have another break of 10 minutes and we can come back at, let's say 5 to 11. Is that okay?
Yep. Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you and see you in 10 minutes.
In the chat.
I guess I present everything very clearly.
Sure.
I'm happy for that. Okay. Then it's full screen.
Not here in the screen.
Not yet, but
yes.
Now?
Now it is, yes.
Yes. So, online brain platform was developed within Zero Brain in order to facilitate materials exchange. The online brain platform is abbreviated as OBP, and the platform is an active web of service which aims to promote the secondary materials flow. And this is achieved by linking the brain producers, also called brain owners, with minerals and water end users, and also involving in this symbiotic relationship the technology providers and the waste heat providers. So, similar to what the Brine project is aiming to do, when I mention minerals, I don't only mean sodium chloride, so salt, but there is a big list of minerals that it is typically part of brine, part of brine flows, brine compositions, and all those minerals are mentioned. They exist in the lists in the OBP. But I would also welcome if the participants, if you would like to add to suggest other minerals to exclude which do not exist yet. So I would also like to remind you that the protection of sensitive data is taken into account during the platform design. The only data that are visible to users, to people who have registered, is the username and also the email address that was used for the registration. The rest information is not visible, and you will see what information is is needed for the registration process in a short video that it is following. And other data is also not obligatory. So for example, when I made my account, I think I didn't add that I belong to an industry or any NACE code, so any economic, European economic activity code. And if a user has inserted sensitive information like the company that he belongs to and the company that, let's say, is producing the brine, this information is only available to another user when the first user gives consent to do that. And this happens only in certain cases when this symbiotic relationship can happen, called matching process. And I will also explain this later. So in general, there are different circular business models. Some of those, they focus on the circular supply chain. Other, they focus on the recovery and recycling of materials. Other are focusing on extending the product life. Other circular business models, they perceive products as a service. And in this case, for example, the product doesn't belong to the consumer, but it is a service and belongs to the company where it is sold. And we can already see this case, for example, with bikes in the Netherlands, where somebody is getting a bike and is paying an amount of money every month. And then if something happens with the bike, the company that collects the money that sold the bike to that person needs to do the maintenance. And then there are also sharing platforms. The purpose of the platforms is the same like the purpose with the OBP. It is to promote and facilitate the renting, swapping, or sharing of resources and infrastructure among individual or companies. And the objective is to achieve collaboration among them. Such a sharing platform can allow multiple users to use similar resources and thereby reducing their demand of raw resources by reusing the waste or treating the waste and creating feedstock. And the online blind platform is aiming to do that. So the website of the OBP looks like that. I will describe it later in detail, but first, it is nice to watch a video recorded by Revolve, the National University, National Technical University of Athens, regarding the OBP and mainly the registration process. So now I should know, share computer sound, yes. There is no sound yet, by the way.
The Online Brine Platform is an interactive matchmaking platform promoting synergies between value chain industries, thus furthering industrial symbiosis, resource efficiency, and circular economy. The Online Brine Platform matches brine owners that can offer untreated saline streams or those already recovering materials with brine reusers such as mineral or water users, as well as waste heat and technology providers. To register to the Online Brine Platform, go to zerobrine.eu. Under the project menu, select Online Brine Platform. On this page, you will be presented with two options, to log in and register. First-time users will need to register. To register, first create a username, secure password, and an email address. The user can choose to register with only a username and a password, in case they want to keep their profile hidden from others. For users that register their industry name and location, their identity is revealed to other users only after they consent, or when they have been matched to another user. You can add your company or industry name, and for companies based in the Netherlands, you can designate a specific industrial cluster. You also have the option to add an NIC code, or National Classification Code, and your company's website. You can add your company's address, with the option to make your company's location visible to other users. This can be helpful for forming symbiotic relationships with other industries close by. Lastly, you can add an NACE code. Once you agree to the terms, your registration will be complete. You will receive a confirmation email with an activation link in order to log into the platform. To ensure successful matches on the Online Brine platform, we encourage all users to complete their profiles with the requested data. Incomplete profiles can lead to uncertainty for other users, lessening your chances of being matched. For users that only register with a private profile, you can update your profile information once logged onto the platform. To begin on the Online Brine platform, select your user role as a brine owner, end user, waste heat provider, or technology provider. You can have one or more user roles. To register as a brine owner with untreated brine streams, you will need to add your saline effluents and their characteristics, as well as the materials to be recovered and their characteristics. If recovering materials, you will need to specify what is being recovered with their quality parameters and information on the recovery process. As an end user or mineral or water user, you will need to select the required materials, their uses, the quality required, and any additional parameters required for minerals. As a technology provider, select which technology you provide for treatment of saline effluent. As a waste heat provider, select your waste heat type, its temperature, pressure, flow rate, and flow rate variation. Once you have filled in the respective data, on the side menu, a suggested matches tab will appear. Level 1 matches are good quality. Other matches will also be recommended, even if quantity of resources is limited. You will then be allowed to message these users directly. In addition to the Online Brine platform, the Online Brine portal, which is also accessible at the bottom of the Online Brine platform webpage, is an additional resource to support technical aspects of brine stream and valorization opportunities. Consult the Online Brine portal should you need information or support on the following. Brine streams generated by process industries based on scientific and BREF documents, industrial uses and properties of minerals based on REACH regulation, or descriptor categories such as nomenclature of economic activities, European waste category, product category, technical function, article category, or sector of use.
Okay, so these were a few information about what is needed for registration. And as you saw, users will register their organizations. They can fill in some contact details. Some are private and others are visible, and the private information, they are not obligatory, but they're going to be very helpful when a company that is producing brine with a certain composition matches with another company that can make use of that materials that don't exist in the brine producer company. Therefore, you need to define your role in the website, in the OBP. There are some input details that I will show in a few minutes. And then there is a search by the algorithm of the OBP to find matches, and the matches belong in level 1 and level 2 matches, and I will explain also this. And finally, when users who have matched give consent, then they can exchange more private, let's say, information regarding their brine and regarding the materials that are interested in. And finally, the users can also communicate. So therefore, it is important that when a company is inserting data, this data should have a certain level of detail in order to have this matching opportunities. So if I stop sharing my screen and I go to my browser. Let's see. So now you can see my browser.
Yeah.
And I go to the Online Brine platform website. This is based on my profile, I have already registered, of course, and then I received the confirmation email. So right now, you can see based on the design of the website, there is the dashboard. There are some tabs on the left side. Okay, we log in. Maybe it was done long ago, so I need to log in again. So on the left part, you can see the dashboard. You can see the role that my account has, and this can be changed. So I will show you, I will guide you how to input, how to insert data and what kind of data is needed per role. We will see matches if exist. We will also search the users that already exist in the platform and the rest of the options that the website gives. So as we can see right now, in total, there are 2,300 users, but unfortunately, not all users have inserted data with a certain level of detail in order to have matches. And as a result, the matches are only 10. And from all those users, 6 have inserted what kind of effluence they are having, producing. What kind, 4 of them have inserted what kind of recovered materials they are interested in. And 8, what kind of, what kind of materials they are recovering and what kind of materials are required by the industries. 17 users are technology providers, and 5 of them are waste heat providers. And so far, the dissemination and communication of the online brand platform was focusing on the Netherlands. So all the users right now, they should come from the Netherlands. So let's say that I want to select a role. And as you saw in the video, there are 4 roles. There are the brand producing companies called brand owner. There are the end user companies called minerals and water users. And there are the companies who can provide the technology to treat the brine and recover the required materials. And also there are waste heat providers because there are many processes that require a certain heat input. So they're happening at high temperature, and it's always beneficial if waste heat can be incorporated. In this way, we are still linking the symbiotic relationship to the circular economy concept and the sustainable development concept where we're trying to reduce the environmental footprint. So the brine owner is classified, role is classified in 2 cases. One is that the industry is generating the brine, the saline wastewater stream, or the industry is aggregating saline wastewater stream from other industries. In both cases, this company is the owner of the brine, so this company should insert data regarding the brine. So if I update my user profile, so I click on update, and then the OBP will ask me 2 things. First is to add the composition of the brine, and the second is to add if I already recover some of the materials from my brine. Because if I already recover materials, then it's much faster to find an end user who would be interested in those materials. Otherwise, a technology provider is very beneficial, and also a waste heat provider is always beneficial for the heat that the process needs. So let's say that so far I don't know, or I'm not recovering any materials, and I'm going to insert data for my brine generation. So at first, we see the identifier with my name. That's why the name is also that it is visible, the username. This is my username. The username is visible to other accounts, users. And then we can see that the website asks me for the flow, the daily flow, the monthly flow, the total dissolved solids in grams per liter, the chemical oxygen demand, concentration of my flow, the biological oxygen demand, and the NACE code, and also the European waste code. However, not all of this information are mandatory. You can see the obligatory information with the asterisk, so it's only the monthly flow and the total dissolved solids flow. And in some cases, there are minimum values. So for example, if I say that I am producing 100 cubic meters per month of brine, and I have only 1 gram per liter. Let's see if this. So based on experience and based on brine compositions in Europe and in general, the website is telling us that the minimum total dissolved solids in the brine can be 2.5. And this is also related to how economic can be to recover those materials. Because if also there was no solids, then it would not be brine, but maybe some other kind of water. So let's say I have 5 milligrams per liter. And let's say that my company, we can see also the different codes for the European waste. So let's say that my company is extracting coal from underground mines, and this would be waste resulting from exploration, mining, etc. And this coding is 0.1, so you can see here 0.1. And then I can make it even more specific. Let's say it is from waste from mineral excavation, 0.1, 0.1, and then from non-metallic excavation, metallic and ferrous. So then I will press next. By the way, you can interrupt me if you have any question. This is still one. So then the website, the platform is going to ask me if I already know what materials I can recover, or if I'm interested in being informed what materials I can recover based on my composition. So this means that I should already be aware of the composition of my brine. And this is usually the case because if a company needs to dispose the brine, they need to check if they can dispose it, or when they have some wastewater that they want to dispose, they need to check if the wastewater can be disposed freely or there is regulation about it. So usually the composition or elements that are the majority or the main elements of the wastewater are known. Otherwise, there are also the brine excellence centers, which have analytical equipment that can help you with that. And let's say first that I do know the composition of the brine, but and therefore I want the platform to propose me minerals. So let's say that I have a brine rich in sodium chloride, rich, relatively rich. So let's say 500 grams per liter, and then sodium the same. And these are anions and cations, by the way, that you have to fill. And let's say that there is also magnesium in that brine, because magnesium hydroxide, as I presented, when it is imported from Russia, is a conflict mineral, high in conflict mineral. So then 100 grams per liter in my brine of magnesium. And then I will ask the platform to suggest me minerals that I can select. And in this case, Of course, it is sodium chloride and magnesium chloride. And based on the brine monthly flow that I have inserted earlier, it also tells me how many kilograms per month exist in that flow. If I don't, if I have seen that I have made some mistake, I can say try again. And at the same time, if I already knew what kind of materials I can recover, then I can press this and we can see both of the options at the same time. And then if I click here, there is a drop-down list with all the materials that can be recovered. And as you can see, there are many materials based on sodium, potassium, calcium, chromium, zirconium, magnesium, etc. So let's say that I have already identified sodium chloride, magnesium chloride, and I know that I also have water that I can recover. And then we can combine both options and click yes. And then based on the concentrations that I have inserted earlier and based on my monthly flows, we can see here my data. And for the water flow, let's say there is, this is per day. So let's say it is 12 cubic meters per day. And this is from effluent zero, because I can also have more effluents. We will see. And then the website will tell me if there is no problem that the saline effluents have been added successfully. And it also asks me for feedback. So if I press this button, a few questions will pop up regarding what I did so far and in order to give feedback and improve how the platform works. So if I can go to my role and I press here in my saline effluents and I see that I have my Georgialidis effluent zero with this amount of monthly flow, this amount of total solids and this kind of materials that can be recovered. I can edit them. I can edit. And if I go back, I can also delete it. And at the same time, if I'm a company that I'm already recovering materials, I can also, and also producing brine, then I can also add recovered materials. I can go here. And there are also some steps. Again, a drop-down list will appear with what kind of materials exist. And here I will need, let's say only these two, I will need to give more information in order to have good matching opportunities with end minerals and water users. Minerals and users and water and users. So then I will add some qualitative parameters for water, which is one, and sodium chloride is my second mineral. It will ask me about the water flow. It will ask me about pH and other parameters, which are not mandatory to add, because I understand that it is not known for every brine producer, even if materials are recovered. I can add impurities that exist in the water and also microorganisms that can be detrimental to our health. And for the sodium chloride, the information asked are less. It mostly involves heavy metals and purity. And let's say my purity, for example, is 99.5 and moisture content is 0.4 and the rest could be impurities. And then if I go below, I can press next. And then, since I'm recovering these two type of products, water and sodium chloride from my brain, the platform is going to ask me what kind of technologies are involved in this recovery. And again, this information is not mandatory. So there are different technologies which also exist in the technology provider's role. So let's say that I'm using an evaporator and also reverse osmosis. Reverse osmosis here. So only reverse osmosis would be fine. Then the platform is also going to ask me capital values and operational values. And these are really sensitive information for some companies. That's why this is again not an obligatory data entry. And then the third step, not the third step, the third data entry is regarding environmental data, which is also quite advanced, I would say, for most companies, especially the functional unit, which is a term coming derived from life cycle assessment methodology. And then indicators, life cycle assessment indicators, meaning what kind of environmental impacts I have due to the recovery of brine. And these impacts can be global warming, acid rain, eutrophication, toxicity, cumulative energy demand, etc. And these are typically presented per a functional flow, per product, let's say. And this is why it asks here the functional unit, but this is, I would say, quite advanced for the majority of companies. And then I will press finish. And then if I go again to the left side, I have my saline effluents. So these are the materials that I'm expecting to recover. But now, let's say I'm also a company that already is recovering some materials, and then these materials can be used to identify matching opportunities. Again, I can delete the materials or modify the qualitative information. And something that I didn't mention is that, I mentioned everything. So these are more or less the data inputs that are needed for the brine owners, the brine producers, and only a minority of data is mandatory, mainly how much is the monthly flow of brine, and then it would be the total dissolved solids. And also I would suggest that it's really beneficial if the composition of the brine, or at least some materials that we know or that you know that can be recovered, can be included when somebody is registering in this role. And so I will go here, and then I will show you what are the different roles. I don't know, Case, are there any questions yet?
No questions in the chat, but everyone then, feel free to make comments in the chat.
Yeah, sorry, even interrupt me, this is also possible. And then I will go and change my role, and after we see what kind of information is needed for the users, for the end users, then we can also go and see different matching opportunities. So let's say now that I'm an end user. So I have a company that it is consuming certain minerals, certain materials. And then I will go, and again, there's going to be a drop-down list. And let's go for the most, the ones used in most cases, so water, sodium chloride, sodium chloride and magnesium chloride. I can also write it down, and then it will filter the ones that I have selected, the next, and then it will ask me if the water and every end product, every product is used in one process or in several processes. Because if it is used in more than one process, then maybe different characteristics are essential per process. So if I say here, no, then it will ask me for the different uses. And I can also add more, depending on in how many cases I use, in this case, water. So let's say I'm using water in one process. It is processed water. Then it has an identifier. George Salida is required because I'm an end user in this case, water one. And there is the flow that I need on a daily basis. And let's say it's 3 cubic meters per hour. I will use a small number to see if there are higher opportunities of having matches. Then the same for the sodium chloride, I use 10 kilograms per month of sodium chloride. I can add the sector if I'm interested, what kind of sector I belong to, what kind of product category, what kind of article category, and what's the technical function. Whatever the required mineral you have inserted, the drop-down list will be the same. So yes, that's why you also see such a long list in every case. So let's say, so now I have 3 cubic meters of water per day, 10 kilograms of sodium chloride per month for George Salidis identifier one, and this would be two, because it also has a different, yes. So it's magnesium chloride one. The identifier also depends on the uses of the material and how many processes. And for magnesium chloride, again, 10 kilograms per month, which is small quantity in general. Then the platform will ask me for qualitative information for the material. So the purity, let's say 99%. And then for the magnesium chloride, it is 65%, the purity. And then there is no mandatory information. So I can press next. And then it will ask more information about the two minerals. And here it is, this is an error. This would be magnesium chloride finish, because I don't want to insert any other information. We're also running out of time a bit. And right now I have my required materials. I have processed water with a certain quality, but I haven't inserted the quality. And I also have magnesium chloride and sodium chloride. So right now, if there are companies that are producing water, magnesium chloride and sodium chloride, and of course I haven't inserted qualitative characteristics, but if at least the flows from prime producer is enough, maybe we can have a match with respect to the materials themselves. So now you can see here already that there is an additional option called suggested matches. And if I click it, there is level one and level two matches. So level one matches regards the kind of material. So if there are brine producers who are producing sodium chloride and magnesium chloride, the quantity of the material and the geographic location of the user. As we can see, if I press level one, I see that there is um, we can see on the left side the brand producers. So in this case, it is NTGA with different materials. And there is also another user called. And then it's my the data that I have inserted, my required materials, the industrial name, and then I can see that there is sufficient quantity. The distance is not included because when I created my account, I haven't stated where my company belongs. Where my company is located, and then there is the action to give consent. Otherwise, I can communicate from the last column, from the right column. I can message, but I cannot give personal information when I have when I made my registration. And the same applies in this case. Maybe she has inserted her company name and real company name, where it is located, as sensitive information. So in this case, she also needs to give consent to me in order to exchange this kind of information and then talk and then advance our talks. And the level two matching, it regards, again, the kind of material, the quantity of the material, and the distance, so the location of the two users, roles, but then also the quality of the material. And in this case, I have inserted the quality only about sodium chloride, for example. And I can see here that I have a matching rate of 49, so 50% and 32%. And then again, you can see here, in order to have private data, this account was called BBB, but sodium chloride is recovered with a certain quality, as far as I can understand. So there are another two roles which I can state quite fast. And by the way, when I'm exchanging roles, it can be the case that the materials or the data inputs that I have inserted, they will remain. So that's why we may see still some matches, but they don't exist in reality. Although if a user would use with register as a, would register and then create a selected role, yes, usually they wouldn't change their role, but in this case, it's only for the tutorial section. So the involved technologies, again, there is a drop-down list based on the technologies that we saw earlier when a company is recovering itself minerals and water from their brine. It's a quite a long, there is a big range. Let's say that I have nanofiltration and then I say save. And then if I go to my technologies, I see that this is the only technology that exists. And then if I change the role and I go to waste heat provider and I update my user profile, it will ask me to add the weight heat and the qualitative characteristics of the weight heat. So let's say I have flue gases, I burn something, I burn diesel, I burn coal, and I have some flue gases at a temperature. Since it's waste heat, let's say I already incorporate some of the heat that it is produced, and this is at low temperature, 150 degrees, atmosphere, flow rate, and the platform is even going to ask me if there is a range in the flow rate, because the flow rate can really change between day and night, and also weekdays and weekends. And then I will press submit. And then I will have my WASTkit flows, which I can again modify or delete or add more. And then what other options do I have in the platform? I can check, I can find all the users that I have identified as technology providers and filter them based on all the considered technologies. And again, I cannot see sensitive information. It depends what its user has inserted. I can do the same, and I can also message them, because let's say that I'm a company that I know that I have this kind of brand composition, and I know what to expect from recovered materials, and then I will search for the company that can provide the technology to recover these materials. And even if there is a match one and match two, I know that I have a brand with a certain composition, and there is already an end user in the online brand platform that needs this material with a certain composition, with a certain quality, then I can go out and search for a technology provider that can provide this technology, and then make business. So we have the WASTkit providers again. I can also filter them, I can message them. I have all users with respect to saline effluence. Every time it shows 10, and then I can change this. I can filter them by the material. I can filter them in order to start with the highest monthly flow or with the lowest monthly flow. Recovered materials, I can do the same. I can go to user by role, and then I can filter them. And so I can see all the users, but of course the information that I can see per user is really limited. And only if two users give consent, then we can see more information for the other user, but at the same time, we can also message the users, and maybe this is also another way to exchange information. And then I can go to statistics and metrics, and I can see how many users exist per cluster, because initially the platform was developed for the Dutch industry. So I can see how many users exist per clusters, how many rates, and what is the matching rate, and how many users are matched. I can also see the range of the registered effluents and the range of the users depending on the NACE economic activity code. I can see my messages, if somebody has sent me a message in order to interact with me, my notes, assignments from the platform, from the administrators, frequently asked questions where you can check quite fast if you have any further questions about the platform, and also links to the OBB portal and the Zero Prime project. This is in a nutshell. I don't know if there are any questions in the chat, or everything was clear so far.
I think it was very extended and clear. And if people want to ask questions, they can use the chat or now interrupt us as well.
I have also prepared a poll if there are no questions regarding the online brand platform. So as I said, I'm going to distribute the questionnaire later on. I would like to share it with everybody in order to collect information regarding the platform and the registration to the platform. So I would also like, yes, I will do this later, but for now there is a very brief questionnaire regarding some of the things, some of the options, chances that the online brand platform is offering. So one is regarding matchmaking capabilities. Do you think that the level one, which is focusing on the kind of material, quantity of material and the location is enough? And then there is also the second level, which adds the qualitative information about minerals and water. Then it's about, people are interested in registering their own brand streams and to the platform. If you are interested in registering quality characteristics of minerals employed in your facility, so the first is about brine producers, the second is about end users of minerals and water. And then if you are interested in registering quantities of minerals used in your facilities, then if you have any considerations or reservations, and I will be very interested in listening, what you think could stop you from registering your brine effluents or materials that you are consuming, and how do you think it can be improved? This is more of an open question that also exists in the questionnaire, but and if you think that there are
people can use the chat also to give their
yes.
So if they think something can be improved, please use the chat, or maybe you have some time to speak about it.
Yes, because the following minutes are going to wrap up everything we said today. So yes, there is still some time to have some brief discussion, especially about objections, about registering the platform. If you think something is missing from the platform, please feel free to say the one of the reasons for this webinar is not only to show the platform and to promote it to everybody, but also to find ways to improve it in order to achieve a circular economy and industrial symbiosis faster via the platform. So there is no, it's a non-profitable platform because it is part of the European project. So the aim, for us at least, is not to make money from the platform. But so yes, feel free to state anything that you think it should not be there, maybe it's not useful, maybe something is missing.
Can I say something, George?
Of course.
Because let's say these kind of platforms have been developed before, and I think this is a very good example. So I'm not saying this to make it weaker or so, because I think it's a good example. But platforms have been made before, and what we have concluded, because we also have analyzed a couple of those platforms, is that the personal and so really the individual interaction is very important to give it a success. So at one hand, you exchange information and you fill in your data, and I think you showed it very nicely how much details you actually can fill in as a partner or as a contributor. But then the next step would be that someone moderates that and also brings people into contact with each other. Is that something you also have in mind? Is that something you are planning to have a follow-up, that someone is checking regularly the platform and then say, hey, here's a company A and B, they haven't found each other, but I think there's a match?
Thank you, Gijsbert. The moderator is the National Technical University of Athens.
Mm-hmm.
And the platform, I know it's going to continue working even after the Zero Prime project finishes in the end of this year, close to the end of this year. Regarding the moderators bringing companies together, I cannot really reply to that question because, yes, I'm not the moderator, but I can also imagine, due to data privacy, so far, at least, the moderators have kept like a distant attitude, behavior, in order, yes, I think to show that the data are private, etc. I think that's the attitude that they have followed so far.
Yeah.
It would be really interesting, yes, to ask them what can be done from a moderator's side in order to motivate exchange of information at this point.
Yeah. What might be, let's say that there's a very interesting example from the UK. It's called a NISP framework. So that's NISP actually stands for National Industrial Symbiosis Platform, which has a lot of similarities with what we're doing here. And what is, I think, a strong point in that NISP platform, and I know that also the people in Athens actually know exactly how that platform works, but what is a strong point there is that they do the same, that they collect data and so on, so do it online. At the same time, they offer, you could say, a kind of consultancy. They even have raised and founded a firm on that, that actually does that. It's called International Synergies, that firm. And what they do is first firms and factories deliver the data. And if there's anything interesting, then the firm steps in, so the International Synergies, and then offer their consultancy activities. And then you can, in that consultancy activity, you can actually do anything you like with the confidentiality. You could say, we first sign a contract together. And that is the reason that you can give me more information, or you make sure that we will protect it. But of course you need a broader harvesting, but then it would be very nice to have a follow-up by saying, I understand that this is sensitive information, but perhaps if we offer that as a consultancy advice to you and we sign a contract together that your data will be protected, then perhaps you can share more data with us and then we can see if we can even help you further. Because of course there's always this issue of this is an open platform, but factories might also be helped more if they know that their data is protected and so on. And yeah, the question would be, of course, if there is a possibility to have this extra step on top of it. And perhaps that's even beyond the Zero Brine project. So for the Zero Brine project, this online platform is designed as we planned it. But now the question would be, if you say, how can we improve it? I think this extra data protection step that also takes confidentiality seriously, it might be a very good step.
Yeah, that's very interesting. Thank you, Hasbert. I would also be interested if people who have considerations or reservations about registering in the platform would like to comment on that, because I think this topic is really related to them. If it would work this way, we can also contact the moderators and then and the rest of the Zero Brine partners and then discuss about it.
Yeah, I think that this moderation or an automated moderation by the platform itself, that really has to do with the privacy and the data that can be supplied. So the platform has really a lot of privacy security, and that could be beneficial, but also has maybe some disadvantages, like Gijsbert just explained. So if anyone from the audience still would like to step in here or to give feedback why certain things are filled in the questionnaire, because some people said that some things still might be can be improved in the online brine platform, or that some minerals are missing. So if you would like to mention that, it's very nice. And if not, maybe later via other media, you can also reach us.
Yes, so these few questions are also part of a bigger questionnaire. Still, it's a questionnaire that takes about, I would say, 5 minutes to fill in. And we would like to distribute this to everybody in order to collect information regarding how to improve the platform. And please feel free to do so. So if I stop the polling, yes, I also didn't share the results. Sorry for that. And so the majority of people are satisfied with the matchmaking capabilities of the platform and are interested about registering characteristics, mostly about brand streams. I see about minerals used, the participants, you are a bit more hesitant about this kind of information.
Could also be that some people don't need minerals at all in that process.
That's true, but then it's based on the yes on the replies. Are you interested? Yes, true. I get what you mean now, yes. And there are considerations or reservations about registering, so I will be very interested. Yes, very welcome. I will be very welcome if you can fill in the questionnaire and let us know why, so we can improve the platform. And then, yes, many people, almost everybody thinks it can be improved. That's perfect. But please let us know how. And then we will try to do so also in connection with the moderators, with the platform developers. So I will also stop sharing my screen now. I think we're close to finishing this webinar, this session. It was, first of all, again, thank you very much for everybody joining. This was related, closely related to the Zero Prime project. And Gijsbert presented very well, I think, what the circular economy is, what industrial symbiosis is, and how both concepts are related to industrial ecology, because circular economy is a more popular but also more recent term, while industrial ecology, for example, is much older, term. And then I also presented the Zero Prime project, what it is about, what we're aiming to do, what we have done so far, and also the online brand platform, which is one of the deliverables that this project has. I don't know, Gijsbert, if you would like to say a few things before we close.
Okay. No, I was very happy to do this. I saw in the remarks and the questions and also in the polls, I see how people actually like this topic and how they're thinking on it. So I hope we can continue this. And like you said before, it's, I think, but now I'm speaking for you and not for myself, but I think it's very good if we have input on how to improve the platform. The platform certainly is already quite good. But of course, the participants and the stakeholders in the project, they also have a great say in that. So I hope that this morning also can help to improve the platform even further.
Yeah, exactly. So George, also thank you for the presentations and the moderation of the presentations by Gijsbert. Gijsbert, also thank you very much.
Welcome.
It's very interesting indeed. So. Good to get feedback afterwards with tips. Mm-hmm. For now, I also wish to thank everyone for his attention and presence.
Thank you, Kees. Thank you, Gijsbert. Thank you, everybody. I wish everybody stay safe. And yes, it's a bit early, but it's already December. So I hope we have a good December and good Christmas holidays, even under these conditions. So,